I am not a surgeon, nor do I pretend to be a surgeon, but I used to be a wannabe surgeon, and I certainly interact with patients that I send to surgery, both preoperatively and postoperatively. So any of us, any of the three of us certainly could give this talk, but I got the short straw or the long straw, whatever. So Dr. Mitchell always likes to start this talk with this photograph, because this is the front portico of our facility, and then follow it by the huge mega complex that the University of Colorado is. So he operates primarily at the University of Colorado, which is basically 5 miles due east on Colfax Avenue here. And he has a team of nurses, a team of anesthesiologists, his nurse practitioners and PAs. They have a well-honed team that knows how to take care of these patients both preoperatively and postoperatively. And why is this important? Well, it's long been known that operating on infected lungs is actually quite a lot more difficult, generally speaking, than operating on, let's say, a cancerous lung. And the reason for that is when you're infected, you tend to get anatomic distortion. So the breathing tubes get distorted. The blood vessel tubes in the chest area become distorted. And when you're trying to dissect out those tissues to remove them, which is what we're sending you to surgery for, that takes a skilled eye and somebody who's been around the block several times. So I think we enjoy the fruits of having very good surgical colleagues, not only for our lungs, but we're seeing many more patients today that have these germs in other parts of their body outside of their lungs that may need surgical expertise. And so Dr. Mitchell obviously is our choice of operating on lung tissue, but we have accumulated a team. If we have somebody who has an infection of the wrist with mycobacteria, we have an orthopedic surgeon who works with us, who's an upper extremity surgeon. We have another surgeon who works on lower extremities. We have another surgeon who operates on soft tissue parts like breast infections associated with plastic surgery, things like that. So it's important when you're dealing with these type of infections and thinking about surgical intervention that your team, your physician who's caring for the infection, plus you have a good surgeon who's been around the block a few times and done a few of these surgeries, because you don't want somebody who's a rookie, I can guarantee you. Well, let's start out with a case that he likes to present. And this is our average patient that we would see in our facility, a middle-aged gal, who has MAC by ATS and IDSA criteria. And the important thing about this is she's had several courses of treatment, and unfortunately now her germ has acquired macrolide resistance. So we know that if your germ is resistant to azithromycin or clarithromycin type of medicines, you're likely to have a worse outcome, because that's a very important drug that needs to be included in your regimen. So by this factor, we now start thinking about, well, gosh, in this person who's got a more resistant germ, are we going to start thinking about using surgery as an adjunct to antibiotics in this particular patient? And she has bronchiectasis involving her right lung. And I'm just going to scroll through a couple of the CT scans so that we can show you what this looks like. So it's like a bread slice. So we're doing a slice through her body. Here is her entire body. And we've done a guillotine slice through her body. And this particular cut is about 2 inches down from the top of her breastbone. And we're looking at the underside of that slice. So things are sort of backwards. Where I'm running my pointer is the right lung, and over here is the left lung. You'll see the white lines are blood vessels, so that's not infection. These two black holes are the windpipe, just right after the one pipe splits into one bigger pipe feeding the right lung and another pipe feeding the left lung. And you see these black holes and this black tube. So this black tube is too big. meaning it has become repeatedly infected and inflamed, and it got bigger and bigger so that we can actually see it, and that is what is termed bronchiectasis of a breathing tube. Here we have cavities. See that black hole? So anytime we have problems like this, we think, wow, the antibiotics may not be able to get where they need to get. And in this particular case, one of the good antibiotics doesn't work anymore. So maybe this is a person we need to think about doing surgery. As we go through these slices, we're coming down, down, down towards her belly button. And you see these, it looks like a Swiss cheese right here. So that area of her right lung is irreparably damaged and most certainly is holding on to a lot of germs that I can give you antibiotics till the cows come home. Even if they worked really well, they're not going to be able to penetrate these white areas because there's so much scar tissue there. And in scar tissue, antibiotics can't get there. If you cut yourself on top of a well-established scar, it's not going to bleed much, because the little capillary blood vessels are choked off, so there's no blood delivery to that area, and that's the only way antibiotics are delivered to an area of infection is via the bloodstream. So as we go through, we said, gosh, her left side looks pretty darn good. Yes, there's a little bit of infection right there, and over here on the right side, these little smudgy white dots are probably infection. But overall, the rest of her lung looks pretty good, so maybe we should consider resecting these areas. And this is just a side view of the same CAT scan, but you see on the side, and this is the right side, there's that right, small right middle lobe is irreparably damaged. There's also a little bit tip right here in the front of the right upper lobe that's going to be cut out by Dr. Mitchell when he takes her to the operating room. And there's a front view. There's her heart right there in the middle. So the regimen regarding her antibiotic regimen had to be bolstered a bit because we couldn't use the azithromycin germ. So we added the intravenous amikacin, and we usually give ours 3 times a week. And every week we have a joint conference with Dr. Mitchell and our team, and we present cases that might be considered for adjunctive surgery. So we decided, well, yeah, she probably should have surgery, and we're going to do the right middle lobe and that little bit of her upper lobe as well. And we usually try to time surgery somewhere between 4 and 8 weeks of after the intravenous antibiotic, meaning amikacin, has been in the system. Amikacin has the highest, it's got great benefit, but it also has great potential toxicity. So we have to sort of use our experience to guess, okay, we think this person likely can for sure tolerate a month worth of the 3 times a week IV amikacin, and we know that's really good to help kill as many of those germs. And then we try to continue the intravenous amikacin for at least 2 to 4 weeks after the surgery, again, to help that healing process. So this is where experience sort of comes in, the timing of surgery. Well, we decided that this was going to be a relatively simple surgery that a skilled surgeon could do it through the scope, and that's called VATS, video-assisted thoracoscopic surgery. Usually the patient, if they're out of state, they fly into Denver on a Sunday. They have their preoperative meetings with Dr. Mitchell and the National Jewish Physician on Monday. They have their surgery on Tuesday. They're usually discharged from University of Colorado Hospital Thursday or Friday. They hang out at the hotel Saturday and Sunday and come and see us on Monday to bless them and send them home, and they can fly home on Tuesday. So it's about a 10-day Denver stay on average, but only about a 2 to 4 day stay in the hospital. So it usually works out really well. The surgery, generally speaking, this particular surgery would take about 1.5 hours. And these are the 3 incisions that he generally performs. This is called the working or utility incision. It's on the side of the rib cage. And then he has 2 smaller incisions where the 2 black dots are. The utility incision is about 1.5 inches long. These other 2 incisions are about 1/2 inch long, and they do not need to use the rib spreader to get to the lung tissue, which is a huge benefit for the patient being able to have far less pain postoperatively and recover much quicker postoperatively. So this has been a huge change in the practice of thoracoscopic surgery, kind of transitioning from open thoracotomy, which we used to, I'll just illustrate, we used to do a surgical incision from the upper part of the shoulder blade right down to the bottom of the shoulder blade, right around the side following the contour of the rib, and it was about a 14-inch incision. And this is the old days. Today, I will tell you, even if Dr. Mitchell has to generally, if he has to do an open procedure because he needs better visualization of what he's got to do, his thoracotomy incision, instead of 14 inches, as I just described, is generally about 4 inches. So he has modified this surgical procedure to minimize the amount of trauma to the chest wall. The nice thing about the VATS surgery, as we're calling it, is you don't need an epidural, or gals, if you had a saddle block for your childbirth procedure. That is great for pain control, but if any of you have had those procedures, you know sometimes they're associated with terrible headaches and their own complications. So fortunately, we don't have to deal with that. And he ends up putting a long-acting pain medicine. So you see right here, we're actually looking with a camera on the inside surface of a rib cage. So this is the shiny surface on the inside of the rib cage called the pleura. And there's actually two layers of pleura inside each of our bodies. There are two pieces of saran wrap. And in between the pieces, and one layer of saran wrap is on the inside of the rib cage, the other layer of saran wrap is on the edge of the lung, the outside of the lung tissue. In between each of those layers of saran wrap is 3 tablespoons of liquid, and that's called pleural fluid. And basically what, this is just remarkable. So if you've ever had two pieces of flat glass with some water in between them, you have to slide them apart and pop that seal so that you can get those two pieces of glass together. That's the same property that's actually holding your lung inflated against the inside of the rib cage. If somebody has a collapsed lung, it means something broke that seal, a bullet, a broken rib, a surgical procedure, and allowed the air to seep out of the lung so that instead of a lung being this big, it's the size of a cantaloupe when it's deflated. So what happens when you go in for surgery is the anesthesiologist helps you breathe on your good lung, and he lets the air seep out of the lung that's going to be operated on, and Dr. Mitchell sees that during the surgery, and it looks the right middle lobe in this particular procedure, the two good lobes, the right upper and right lower lobe, look nice and pink, and the right middle lobe looks like a deck of cards. It collapses to about the size of my palm, and it's purple, because it doesn't have any good blood flow. So you can visually tell the difference between these bad lobes. And again, back to this photo right here, what they're doing is they're injecting long-acting lidocaine, novocaine, a numbing medicine that will help alleviate pain for a couple days postoperatively. Again, to help you start breathing well so that you can get that lung reinflated and you can get rolling. And it's a pretty cool thing. So this is what the person looks like when they're on the operating table. The operating table, instead of being flat, is what they call, the surgeons call it, broken. So it's kind of bends the patient's rib cage and really opens up. Normally, gals' ribs are really close together, like my hand. When we break the table and spread that rib cage, at least spreads them open so he has better working area to work with. And again, he doesn't have to insert what's called the rib spreader, so that improves pain. You see the arm is one arm is up in a sling, essentially, and that's where the blood pressure cuff is. The other one is lying out straight. And these are the tables with all of the instruments, and the nurse is standing there. So he uses all sorts of very expensive, funky tools and gadgets, and he likes to look at these pictures. It doesn't mean anything to me. But you see this nice little alligator, little clipper, and oh, this curvy thing. That looks pretty nice. I don't know what they do. So this is what's really important. And yesterday when we lectured to the physician course, when Dr. Mitchell goes out and lectures to his colleagues, this is something he really reinforces. So what this picture is illustrating is this is the person's skin. And this is one of the working incision, the utility incision, that's about 1.5 inches. And anytime any of us have surgery these days, they, yes, scrub up the skin first, and then they put a sticky piece of saran wrap over the skin. And then they'll slice through that saran wrap when they're making whatever incision they're doing to whatever body part they're doing the surgery on. In addition, what Dr. Mitchell figured out is that we needed to put a extra barrier that's about that long, and it's got two rings, one ring that goes inside the skin and this other ring that's outside. And it's a different layer of protection, so none of this tissue right here or anything that he's going to pull out from inside the rib cage will contaminate the edges of the skin. That's very important for, particularly for the germ Mycobacterium abscessus, because Mycobacterium abscessus can cause an additional infection on this skin if it touches the skin. So we don't want to contaminate that. And in the old days when I started, his predecessor, Dr. Pomerantz, figured out that if you painted each layer before you put the stitches in it to close, the lung, the muscle, the rib, with a solution called betadine, that we had far fewer infections. Well, this has changed the whole game. We really don't have infections, post-operative infections, because of contamination. Mycobacterium avium doesn't cause the skin infection. It's the abscessus germs. They are a nasty group of germs, I have to tell you. So they draw out where their landmarks are, and they've drawn out the contour of the shoulder blade. Here's that one little incision there. There's the working incision, and that will ultimately be what's called the chest tube site. They're going to use it during the surgery, but afterwards, you have to put a drain tube in to suck the residual air out so that the lung then reinflates over the next day. Plus, there's about a tablespoon of loss of blood, not much at all. It's a very bloodless surgery. And unlike when you're doing an open procedure where the surgeon is actually looking directly inside your rib cage, now with the video, he's not looking at the patient really. He's looking at the camera up here. And so what he's looking at, there's the inside of the rib cage that I showed you. Here's the collapsed lung tissue down here. And he's going to do all his wonderful things by looking in that particular video camera. This is his primary OR nurse, and it's very funny because her name is Melissa Mack. And so it's crazy, right? I mean, who would do that? So Melissa's a big help and a major portion and person in the team. So what are the indications? What do we think about doing surgery on people? Well, the major things are if we have it, one area or two areas that are really damaged and what we call bronchiectatic. So again, there's a lot of scarring. There's very little blood supply. That's one reason. If we have a hole, if we have a cavity, that's another reason. And both of those are problematic because those are areas where many germs can stay and hang out and replicate and not have access to these wonderful antibiotics that we're giving them. In a cavity situation, it's like bats hanging on the inside of a cave wall, right? These germs are hanging on the inside of that cave wall, and most of our antibiotics can't penetrate fully into that cave. So those are where we think surgery should be at least be considered as an adjunct. A question that we get all the time, some patients say, oh man, I can't tolerate the medicines. Can you just take me to surgery and take out the damaged lung? Well, that can't happen. It's got to be some kind of antibiotics combined with surgery. We just don't take somebody to surgery without any antibiotics being on board as well. That's very important. It's not either or. You have to implement both. And what's the goal of surgery? Well, obviously, the goal of surgery is ultimately to get you to culture negativity and get you off of antibiotics and certainly get your quality of life to improve. So those are the three major goals that we have. And the symptoms Cough is a huge one. So we do surgery not only for patients with NTM associated bronchiectasis, but Pseudomonas or other organisms, but mainly it's the structural problem with the lung that is so distorted because of the prior damage, and that often leads to such coughing that we can give antibiotics till the cows come home, but that we have to get that area of damaged lung out, and it really does improve patients' quality of life. The other thing that we've noticed is that if you have a damaged part of your lung, particularly in the upper parts or mid parts of the lung, basically, and this is not really the case, but it is sort of the case, the lung is dissolving. And you have little drips and drabs of mucus and sputum that has a high concentration of organisms that can trickle to current healthy areas of the lung. And what surgery might provide is prevent inoculation of these germs and inflammatory products to other parts of the lung that are currently healthy. So we're trying to preserve healthy real estate, essentially. So the presentations vary considerably, as we've talked. This is kind of the typical right middle lobe, and this area on the left side is called the lingula, right middle lobe lingular Lady Windermere presentation, if you ever read that. And this gal has breast implants, so we see so many thin women, and many of them have had breast implants. Now, the question always was, oh gosh, is there any relationship to implants and the development of this? No. It's probably just a result of most of these gals are thin and they want to enhance their appearance. We also look at people with cavities. So you see this cavity in the upper part of the lung. You can imagine what used to be here was lung tissue. And so this person coughed and spit and coughed and spit and maybe coughed up a little blood, but all the while some of that liquid can trickle down to the bottom parts of either of these lungs and cause worse infection in this area. So that would be something we would consider taking out surgically. Here's another case where basically this lung is gone. The entire left lung, there's nothing there. And what we see, you see that flat line there, is called an air fluid level. So there's liquid that's sloshing around in that chest wall, and that clearly can go to other areas infected. So this would be a lung that we would consider taking out as well. There have been many studies and many case series dating back into the 80s up to now showing, well, gosh, how serious is this surgery and what is the mortality rate? Well, as you can see, the mortality rate, at least by and this was last tallied in 2008, so we've done, you know, thousands of cases now. But the mortality here was 2.6%. And I can say in the last 20 years, I personally have not had any of my patients pass away. So very low mortality rate. Have we had some? Yes. And I'll tell you, the cases of the patients that we lose, in all honesty, are people that have very far advanced disease. They say, I don't want to live like this. I'd rather try to have surgery and see if there's a chance, even though Dr. Hewitt's giving me at least a 50-50 chance of dying. And they don't die on the operating table. They die weeks to months later because their respiratory status was so poor they couldn't survive. So realistically, those are the patients that we see, and those are fortunately very few cases, and all the more reason why we want you to get to good docs early and often so we can deal with your infection long before it became a bad problem. We do, with surgery, have a very good overall sputum conversion rate of up to 87%. Now, it varies from organism to organism. So a little less for the abscessus germs, a lot better for the slow growers. This graph just illustrates the more you do, the better your outcome is. So as you can see, left to right, from 83 to 2001, the volume, and those are the green bars, have increased exponentially of the numbers of procedures, and hence the line is dropping, showing the mortality rate. So the bottom line is you want to go to a center who has a surgeon who's done a lot of these procedures. Predominantly, I mean, these stats, this is our typical patient. A gal somewhere around 60, and We do bilateral resections. So sometimes we'll see, gosh, the patient needs both surgery on the right and the left, and we separate them usually by 8 weeks-ish. Some people who are really healthy and say, nope, I want to do them both while I'm in Denver, we try to do a week apart, do one surgery, let them recover 7 days, and go back into the other side and do the other side. And this next couple, I have a couple of pictures here. This is a picture of a gal that Dr. Mitchell was at our mall, and she had had her first surgery and then it kind of had 2 weeks between her surgeries, and so this is 4 days after her second surgery. He just happenstance came upon her in the mall in front of Tiffany's because she was buying herself a present because she'd made it through both of her surgeries. So he stopped and took a picture of her, and she looks magnificent, and she's doing fantastic. And this was in 2012. So overall, patients do great. When do we think about surgery in regard to a particular organism? We usually always think about it in abscessus, particularly since our antibiotics currently are not the best. So if you have focal damage to the lung tissue and we can get you on some antibiotics, we also think about, should we try to take you to surgery? The caveats are a couple. Number one, we need we call it a prealbumin, which is kind of a protein in your body that we know is so important as an indicator for your ability to heal postoperatively. Your prealbumin has to be in the normal range. So if somebody, I have a patient who was here about 4 weeks ago and she's quite ill and her prealbumin is 8, we need it to be at least 20. 20 to 40 is the normal range for that protein that tells us how good are you going to heal. And her husband contacted me day before yesterday, quite upset, saying, well, when can we do surgery? And I said, her prealbumin on the last measurement was 9. We just can't take her to surgery because she is not going to do well. It's better to try to do things short of surgery because it probably will kill her postoperatively if we do surgery. And that's a very hard discussion to have with patients who want something for their loved one. I mean, it's so painful to have to sort of discuss that, but we know this is the conundrum that we're going to get into, and we'll try anything short of surgery, but we just can't send them to surgery under those circumstances. So that's very important. So to Michelle's lecture, very important to think about nutrition and we've taken people to surgery at prealbumin of 17. That's the lowest I've ever taken someone back, because I'll tell you, I have taken people with less. We came up with this for a reason. People had complications. So we don't want somebody to pass away from a terrible demise postoperatively. We'd rather try other avenues. Pneumonectomies, and what Dr. Mitchell's team looked at is, and other teams have looked at, well, what's the difference between doing surgery for tuberculosis versus NTM infections? And many of the data show about the same. So we have very little operative mortality in all these series. And in the NTM patients, the interesting and striking thing is far more female-centric, because you can see in this NTM series, 72% were female. In the TB series, 72% were male. So quite a difference between, maybe is it the organism? Again, still trying to figure out, why does NTM seem to affect women much more than men? Should I have surgery for NTM treatment? So we get this question a lot, and we entertain that, and you've probably entertained it as well. So can we do it with this simpler method? Because that will make your recovery much better. So that's a point of consideration. And I would say, more often than not, yes, we can do it. He has actually done complete resection of a whole lung through the scope. So he is extraordinarily talented, and that was unheard of 7 years ago. Unheard of. But he's now, with certain patients, he's been able to do that. So that's pretty incredible. This is a person who has something called primary ciliary dyskinesia, and the left lower lobe down here, again, looks like Swiss cheese. That was taken out. It's a very large chunk of real estate, and he was able to do that with the scope. this particular person has a good left lung here, but basically has no lung on the right side because it's been destroyed from infection. And you can see this white rind around here. This indicates he's not going to be able to do this through surgery. So this is kind of the one case that we would encounter that he's just not going to be able to get enough exposure with a scope to get what he needs done through the scope. So he'll have to do a big surgery. This person was done through the scope. And again, it's this Swiss cheese stuff that he's taking out. This he did through the scope as well. He even did that as well. So hardly anything is not accessible by the scope. And I already said, you have to have medicines with the surgery. And when should it occur? That's really for us to decide. Usually we want 4 to 8 weeks of IV amikacin or intravenous drugs if you've got a Rapagor to be in the system before we take you to surgery. And what will my breathing be like after surgery? Good question. Generally speaking, our goal is to not make it any different because we're taking out really bad portions of your lung that are not being utilized currently to breathe anyway. So generally speaking, on a flat surface, you're not going to notice any difference. Where people routinely will notice a difference is, oh, I'm more short of breath climbing upstairs than I used to be. But it's not something that interferes with their life, so to speak. So I went through all those things, and in the essence of time, I won't repeat them. But I think surgery is something to think about and very important adjunct to medication should we need it. So thank you very much.